Good morning, everyone. Welcome here to St. Andrew's for this service of worship. We are delighted to have you all here, and more of which later. But let us begin with these words. Teach me your ways, O Lord. Make them known to me. Teach me to live according to your truth. For you are my God, who saves me. I always trust in you. Shall we stand together and begin our worship of God? We're going to... That is not God, in case... I know we often think the man in the clouds with the beard, but we'll come to him later. Let's stand, we're going to sing Meekness and Majesty.
Heals in humility and washes with love.
And stay seated. We're going to sing one final chorus, one final verse to put ourselves and make ourselves open to God this morning. Let's leave behind the busyness, the hassles of life. Let us be still before God. Lord, we would be still. We would leave aside for a while the rush, the busyness, the noise of the day to be still in your presence. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Folks, please all be seated. Again, let me welcome you all this morning, and especially let me welcome you if you are visiting with us this morning. We are delighted to have you, whether you're here in person or joining us online. You're very much welcome. We hope you feel part of our family here at St. Andrew's Church. I want to pay a special welcome, of course, to those who are joining Michael and Adele and their families for baptism this morning of their beautiful daughter, Scarlett. In particular, I want to welcome members of the lifeboat crew here from Arbroath. Of course, we know Michael has a prominent part in that. He's one of the coxswains of the lifeboat and has been lifeboat obsessed, more or less, since he was in primary school. And so it's good that there are members of our lifeboat crew here this morning. You guys, I want to let you know that actually quite regularly here in this church, we pray for you. We pray for your work. We understand the dangers involved. We understand sometimes the traumas that you guys face up to. And I want to let you know that we here at the church uphold you in prayer. So just so that we can recognize you, would the members of the lifeboat crew are here this morning, just stand in your places, would you, so that we can properly recognize you and thank you for the work you do in this town. Now, that should let you know how much you are appreciated. We really do pray you will know that for sure. Which takes me on to say that today our celebration of baptism is a little different. We will begin here. We will complete the baptism at the harbour. I think we clarified last week, not in the harbour, at the harbour, and in fact on board the lifeboat. And when our service concludes here today, you are all, if you will, if you have time, please do come on down to the harbour in front there of the lifeboat shed. The lifeboat will be in the harbour and the baptism will be conducted there round about 1:45, we hope, or very shortly after it, giving us time to move from here down to the harbour. Michael tells me the forecast suggests rain at 1:00, so we will get down there and crack on, hopefully, before the weather turns. So, that to look forward to, meaning that just a part of the baptismal service will be here in church and the second part down there. Let us begin. The Gospel tells us Jesus was himself baptized in the Jordan by John. As he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens break open, and the Spirit descended on him like a dove. And a voice came down from heaven, "You are my beloved Son, in you I take delight." So Jesus himself was baptized. And then this, Jesus said, "Full authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore to all nations, make them my disciples, baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teach them to observe all that I have commanded you, and I will be with you always, even to the end of time." And finally, these words, after the death and rising again of Jesus, his followers, we read this. On the day of Pentecost, the Apostle Peter said, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus the Messiah, that your sins would be forgiven, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." This promise is to you and to your children, to all who are far off, and to everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself. And so with these scriptural injunctions, we believe that it is right that even now, 2,000 years later, the church continues to celebrate baptism as both a sign of God's love, which reaches out to us, and this morning to Scarlett, long before she or we are able to understand it for ourselves. And secondly, that baptism is a sign of welcome into the family of God. So with these things in mind, and with these scriptures assured, let us bow our heads and let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you are in the business of reaching out to us in grace and love. Yes, reaching out to us long before we can possibly know you or understand you for ourselves. You make the first move. And so by baptism, you welcome us to yourself. You assure us of life, new life, and life in all its fullness, and the gift of the Holy Spirit indwelling. And so be with us this morning as a church. Use our obedience to Christ and the water of baptism that Scarlett, whom we will baptize in your name, would truly be received into the number of your faithful people, and in time as she grows, that she would come to know for herself just how much you love her. These, Lord, are our prayers, and we ask them in Jesus' name. Amen. Michael and Adele, the questions, first and foremost, are yours as Scarlett's parents. So, Michael, can I ask you to take Scarlett, please, and would you both please stand? Michael and Adele, first of all, I ask you to declare your own faith in these terms. Do you believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? And do you take Jesus Christ to be your Savior and your Lord? Thank you. It is because of your declaration of faith that we can welcome Scarlett in this way. Would the godparents please stand? Thank you. A question for you. Do you promise in every way you can to support Michael and Adele as they seek to raise their daughter? Thank you. Would the whole congregation please stand? Baptism is corporate as opposed to private. And so as a church, we all have a part to play in baptism. And specifically this, It is our role as members of the church to make sure that this place is a place where children are truly welcome. Even when they squawk, even when they greet, even when they may run around from here to there, they are welcome, and they are just as much a part of the family as any of you who have maybe been here for 50 or 60 years or more. And so let me ask you this question, and if you would respond, please, we will. Do you promise to play your part as members of Christ Church to ensure that this place is a place of welcome for all children? Thank you. Would you come forward, Michael and Adele? As I said, the fulfillment of the baptism will be at the harbour, but even now, shall we bow our heads and shall we pray? Lord, we thank you for the gift of Scarlet Susie. Yes, the gift. We believe that children are supremely your gift to us. We thank you that you have so blessed Michael and Adele and their families with this beautiful daughter. We acknowledge that you've blessed all of us by giving her into our care as a church family. And so later, as we go to the harbour, be with us, we pray, that her baptism may be complete in your sight and rejoiced in by us and all your faithful people. May your blessing be upon her and this family. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We are going to sing the blessing now ahead of the baptism. So the words will appear on the screen. The Lord bless you and keep you. We sing for Scarlett and we sing for all the children and young people who make up our family. The Lord bless you and keep you. Now, Michael and Elle, you stay standing. If there are others of us, please be seated. I'll put to you now the second of the baptismal questions, which is simply this. Depending on the grace of God, do you promise to raise your daughter in the truths and duties of the Christian faith and within the fellowship of the church family? Thank you. May the Lord bless you and enable you faithfully to fulfill the commitments you have made this morning. Please be seated. Now, here comes Rory with the gift of flowers for Mum. Thank you, Rory. And we have this memento for today, for the baptism, and my thank you Bible for Scarlett, and for you to share with her as she grows. Friends, at Michael and Adele's wedding, we sang the song we're going to sing now. It's a great song for a day like this. It really underlines what it is to be part of the family of God in baptism and as we all are gathered here today. So we stand together and sing, "Oh, how good when the family of God is together in unity. Let's stand together and we'll sing. So this morning we have welcomed Scarlett into the family, and the words of the song remind us that it's a welcome extending to us all. We offer the blessing of belonging, the blessing of belonging, which extends to all people, one and all. Friends, before we break and our children go through next door, let me just refer you briefly to the Sunday morning bulletin, which should be in your hands. I'm trusting you'll take it home and read it at length so you don't miss anything that's going on in the life of the church. But just briefly, on page 5, if you turn to the middle, on page 5 you'll see a number of notices there. First of all, that the Guild is tomorrow night for their meeting. On Tuesday night there is the leadership group. And then next Saturday in the morning, special meeting for all who attended the Safe Talk training towards the end of last year. A whole number of you came to the Safe Talk training. Now, some of you have been able to see you and contact you and let you know personally. If we haven't seen you yet and you were at that training, the Safe Talk training, which is to do with mental health and well-being, come please to that important meeting next Saturday morning. Or if you were not able to be at that training but want to be a part of what this church is going to roll out in the coming months, by way of supporting people who struggle with mental health. Come please to that meeting next Saturday morning where we will share much more. And then next Sunday, there's a soup lunch after service to support our Dementia Drop-In Cafe. And then Messy Church is in the afternoon. Friends, there's a lot more in the bulletin. Take it home with you, please, as I said, and read it to make sure you're up to speed with everything going on in the life of our church. Finally, by way of notices, we have a rose on the communion table this morning, as is our practice, giving thanks for the birth of a child. So this morning we say this: born on the 11th of January, Angus Ramsay Young, a second son for Sarah and Ali, a baby brother for Archie, and a second grandson for Joan Hainsworth, who of course is here among us. Joan serving now as our session clerk, a second grandson for Joan. So Joan, we rejoice with you, with Sarah and Ali and the whole family. And for Angus, we say, thanks be to God. Now we have a creche for the tiny tots, whether in arms or toddling. And then we have a programme, a Sunday club, for boys and girls from 3 years of age up through primary school. Now's the time for them to go through to the halls. If you're visiting this morning, you've got young children with you, you're welcome to take them through now to the halls for their Sunday morning programme. As we go on in our service, part of what we are going to be doing is recognizing the awesomeness of the creation, the wonders of the world in which we live. So to put us in mind of that, let us stand together now as we go on with our worship. We're going to sing, "O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all that you have made." Let's stand together as we worship.
Sings my soul, my Savior.
Please all be seated. Elaine's going to lead us in prayer. And then immediately following that, Ian will read for us the scripture lesson for today.
Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, that we can come together this morning as one people, a family of God with you, our Heavenly Father. You are indeed a great and mighty God. There is no one like you. You have made this wonderful world we call home, our earthly dwelling. The seasons you have set in place, and each one at its allotted time proclaims the wonder of creation. So often, Lord, we fail to notice the beauty of this world around us. Familiarity of the everyday has dulled our vision, and we look down, wrapped up in our own cares, weighed down by our own concerns. And yet, above us, you have stretched forth the canopy of a visible heaven. The psalmist recognizes this in these words. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hand. The sun rises each morning because you have set its pattern, just as the moon shines at night at your command. You, Lord, are the great architect. What is man that you are mindful of him? How small we are compared to all of this, and yet you know us, each and every one of us. You know us and you love us, for you are our God, walking with us day by day, hearing our prayers. Help us this morning to look up, to put aside the trivial thoughts that occupy us or the heavy burdens we carry. Let us instead focus our eyes on you, the God of creation, the God of all things. Nothing is beyond your knowledge or control. Awesome God, we come to you this morning, acknowledging our deep need of you. May we draw close to you as we worship you in Jesus' name. Amen.
This morning's reading is from 2 Timothy, chapter 3, verses 14 through 17, and I'm reading from the NIV. Please read with me, it will be on the wall as well. Verse 14. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the holy scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. May God bless the reading of his word.
Thank you, Ian, for reading for us this morning. Now, as you know, atheists are those who flatly deny the possibility even, or the existence certainly, of God. And then there are skeptics and agnostics who would say, I guess, something like this, that you can't possibly know if there is a God there at all. So don't waste your time worrying or speculating about it. Interestingly, on this point, Christians would agree. You can't know God in that way. He is on another plane, in another realm, high above and beyond what we are capable of knowing. You can't see God, you can't touch him or measure him. You can't use the normal means of ascertaining if something is there or not. No matter how hard you might try, you yourself can't know if there is a God or no God if he is there. Unless, that is, God chooses to make himself known to us. Unless, that is, God speaks. Unless God chooses to reveal himself to us. So I say again as a starting point this morning, we as mere humans cannot possibly know anything of God unless God chooses in his wisdom and love to make himself known to us. This is very different from human endeavor. This is what Christians call revelation. It's that sense of God breaking through into our situation that we might know him. This is not us searching around for God. This is God letting us know who he is and of his nature. And Christians have traditionally called this revelation, God revealing himself to people. It's very different from what is called speculation. That's the stuff of philosophy. We're speaking about something different. Not us trying to work out who God is and what he's like, but God speaking to us of who he is and what he is like. So, revelation. God speaks to us. This is the second in the series of Sunday mornings we embarked on last week and we'll see through till Easter time. There are two kinds of revelation. First of all, I want to say something about what is known as general revelation. This we believe that, well, everyone and anyone can see for themselves. I'll give you two examples of what we call general revelation. Firstly, there is creation itself. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all that you have made, when we gaze around us, when we look up to the skies and beyond into the depths of the universe, we see the creation. Here's what the psalm writer said. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of God's hand. Creation itself reveals knowledge about God. Last week, on several afternoons, late in the afternoon, I was walking along the cliffs and the Vicky Park here in Arbroath. And what wonderful, dramatic sunset skies there were. Now, I know that on one level, that's just a sunset. But for me, and I know for many others, it's much more. It speaks of the wonders of who God is. Creation speaks of the greatness of God, as do the oceans, the mountains, the rivers, and the forests. The majesty of creation speaks of the majesty of the Creator, who, of course, is God himself. And so from the great, the vastness of creation, and all the way down to the tiniest aspects of creation. Even we scarlet, tiny scarlet, this beautiful wee human being, this living thing, reveals something of the glory of God. So whether in the vastness of creation or the fragility of a newborn, when we look closely and below the surface, friends, we see the fingerprints of God. We see what God has done and is doing among us. As we look around, God shows himself something of his character. Look, as Paul puts it in the New Testament, what may be known about God is plain to see because God has made it plain. Since the beginning, God's invisible qualities have been clearly seen in what he has made. The second example of what I'm calling general revelation is conscience. Conscience that we have within us, this seemingly built-in sense that a person has when something is either right or wrong. I know, sometimes that sense is marred within us. Sometimes that sense is damaged, shall we say. But always it is there, deep down. We might call it a moral compass. Why are we like this? Where does that sense come from that is deep within a person that something is inherently right or wrong? Again, I think the Apostle Paul helps us. He says this of it, of our conscience. It is woven in, I love the language, it is woven into the very fabric of our being. There is something deep within that echoes God's right and wrong. Friends, our conscience, again, reveals something to us of who God is. So much then for general revelation, those ways in which we have hints of who God is. Beyond it, Christians believe that there is what we will call this morning special revelation. If general revelation offers us a sense of God, signs of his existence, special revelation reveals much more clearly, precisely, who God is and what God is like. And much further than that, in his special revelation, we begin to know that God loves us and that it is possible to know God and to live in relationship with him. Now, I say again, that is not something that you can just dream up, nor is it something that you can tell necessarily by looking at a mountainscape or the sun going down. It is therefore through special revelation, God speaking specially to us, that we begin to learn of his love and his qualities of grace and mercy, and, as I said, that he wants to be in relationship with us. As with general revelation, I offer you two examples of this special revelation. Firstly, and most supremely, Jesus Christ himself, the Father and the Son. We started with this. It's impossible to know anything about God unless God chooses to reveal it to us. And this he has done most wonderfully and graciously in Jesus, in sending Jesus into the world. He came as a person like us that we might see and know for ourselves who God is and what he is like. And here it is in parts of the New Testament. Again, this acknowledgement, no one has seen God, no one can see God, unless God chooses to reveal himself to us, and this he has done in Jesus, his Son. Jesus has come into the world to make God known. And again, in the same vein from the book of Hebrews in the New Testament, Jesus reflects the brightness of God's glory. Jesus is the exact likeness of God's own being. In other words, friends, when we know what Jesus is like, we know what God is like. God has chosen to reveal himself, to let us know who he is by sending Jesus into the world that we might see for ourselves. This is special revelation, God showing us himself in the person of Jesus. So firstly, special revelation, Jesus. Secondly, special revelation comes to us in the scriptures, the writings that we call the Bible. Writings from a period of over 1,000 years, from more than 40 authors, from countries all around what we now call the Mediterranean and the Middle East. These writings gathered together, and as Christians believe, through them, God even now speaks to us, telling us of Jesus and much more besides. So yes, Christians always have and still do believe that God speaks through his Bible and that his words are flawless. In other words, that they perfectly reveal who God is, not just vaguely or in part, but the scriptures fully and flawlessly reveal who God is. Here it is. The scriptures of the Old and the New Testament bound together in what we call our Bibles. Available to all. The most widely read book in the history of the human race. And we believe of it that it is wholly sufficient, that we don't need anything more outside it or beyond it to know of who God is. Look, it says there, don't add to the words of the Bible. Elsewhere it says, don't take away from the words of the Bible. And yet throughout history, that is exactly what folks have attempted to do. Here we have Joseph Smith, the founder of what we now call Mormonism. Joseph Smith, as you see, lived in the first half of the 19th century in the United States. Joseph Smith claimed that there were extra writings from a Latter-day prophet. The Latter-day prophet was known as Moroni. It's spelled M-O-R-O-N, Moron, but with an I on the end. And Joseph Smith claims, of course, that these writings, these additional writings, were put down on gold plates. And then by a special secret, he was told, Joseph Smith was told, where they were to be found, buried in a cave. He went and discovered them. So he claims, and he wrote them down and published them. And therefore, what we have now is the Book of Mormon. Notice what it is called in the subtext. Another Testament of Jesus Christ. Another, or shall we say, a further, or an additional Testament of Jesus Christ. Orthodox Christians say no. There is no need for anything further than what you have in Matthew and Mark and Luke and John and in the whole of the scriptures. They are fully sufficient. And so anything else that comes after or is claimed as further revelation, Christians have traditionally, and I hope will continue to say no. We reject these additional writings. God is fully revealed. Everything you might ever need to know is in here. in the Scriptures. So some have tried to add to the Bible, folks like the Mormons, while others have tried to take away. Here is Thomas Jefferson, one of the founding fathers of the United States and the third president of the United States. I give you these facts in case they come up on the chase tomorrow. You'll be clued up and clued in. Now, Thomas Jefferson produced his own version of the Bible. He did so with a large pair of scissors. Essentially, Jefferson went through Scriptures and he removed all the bits he didn't like. He removed all the bits that were overly challenging or demanding upon him. And you can still see it. It's in the Smithsonian Institute, even now in Washington, D.C. And still today, people would ignore those parts of the Scripture that they don't want to hear. Even now, people would pick and choose, as if it was as easy as that. I'll just read the bits I like. I'll just read the bits that perhaps don't expect too much of me. Now, the picture of God, which I said wasn't God, which came up right at the beginning of our service this morning, was this guy, Mark Twain. I love what he said. It ain't those parts of the Bible that I can't understand that bother me. It's the parts I do understand. In other words, Mark Twain recognized that the Bible in its fullness is thoroughly demanding upon us. There's stuff in here that is going to ask you to change your life. Well, Jefferson didn't want to change his life, so he cut those parts out. Orthodox Christians will know nothing of that. From first word to last, these are the Scriptures, and we seek to read them, to learn from them, and be obedient to them. We believe, of course, that they are perfect, that they refresh the soul. Don't you love that phrase? Is that something that sometimes you would long for or crave for yourself, a refreshing of your soul? I guess you know what it is to be tired physically, to be thirsty physically speaking. Sometimes a drink of water will refresh you bodily. Are there times when you want your soul to be refreshed? We're told the Bible refreshes the soul, that it can be trusted, and that it gives us joy in our hearts. Friends, if you don't have a Bible, if you don't have a Bible in a modern English translation that is easy for you to read, I personally say this morning, I will buy one for you and put it in your hands. This church will put the Bible in your hands if you don't have one and you want one for yourself. A modern, easy-to-read English translation. That's how much I believe that these pages of Scripture are the way in which God speaks to us even today, of who He is, and that He loves us, wants to know us, and sets out for us a way of life. I believe in it. I'll personally buy you one if you don't have one. Go to the office after service and put your name down. Your address will get you a Bible. Linda, can you check Amazon for the cheapest possible deals on bulk buy Bibles? We believe that the Scriptures were written by human beings, but that these human beings were inspired by an almighty God through His Holy Spirit. Words which reveal truth. And friends, in a world of Brexit lies and Donald Trump fake news, how we need to know a source of truth. Truth for life, that can be depended upon and build your life upon. Words for keeping us right and for showing us how to live this life of ours. Do you know, it's not just a case of make it up as you go along. There's a way to live. And the words of Scripture reveal that way to live. Words, when taken together, that equip us. That equip us for a good and godly life. Words which are to be obeyed. So, friends, unless God Himself speaks and shows Himself to us, we cannot know God other than through idle speculation. But in His love for us, because He wants us to know Him, to love Him, He has chosen to show Himself to us, to speak to us through creation, through the inner conscience that we each have, and supremely through His Son, Jesus Christ, and even now through the words of Scripture. God has spoken. God has revealed Himself. Who is listening? Who is listening? Because this is revelation. It is what God does. It is revelation. God speaking. God reaching to you in love. Let those who have ears to hear and eyes to see know that this is God. Shall we pray? Almighty, everlasting God, we are humbled to know that You love us so much that You have chosen graciously to show Yourself to us in revelation. Forgive us if we have ignored Your voice, not seen what You are doing and saying. Forgive us, Lord. And by Your Spirit, open our hearts, our minds, our spirits to hear You, to see You, to know You, and yes, to love You. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, this next part of our service is what we call the offering. It's an opportunity for us to make an offering, a financial offering, which represents our saying thank you to God. Let me make absolutely clear, if you are a guest, a visitor here at St. Andrew's this morning, there is no obligation upon you to put anything into the offering. It's the responsibility of our members. You're our guests. If you want to, you can, of course, but feel under no obligation so to do. And while the offering is being uplifted, band's going to sing. And the song is, surely our God is the God of gods, the revealer of mystery, the one who reveals Himself to us, surely our God, as the offering is being uplifted. Loving God, we thank you that you are God, the revealer of mysteries who speaks to us. Even now we pray, whisper of your love, that we might know it in our hearts as we lay the offering before you, doing so in Jesus' name. Amen. So friends, we were saying this morning that part of the way in which God reveals himself is through creation, and the third of this series of Sunday mornings we're doing next week, we will focus much more on creation. I've just finished Stephen Hawking, the late Stephen Hawking's most recent book, in which, of course, he asks the deepest and most fundamental questions about the nature of being, how it came into being. And Hawking says, essentially, that he believes there is no need to factor in God to explain existence, to explain creation. We're going to think about that next week. We're going to tackle that, this question of creation and purpose to it. So that's next Sunday. We've got plenty to think about then. If you have time this week, read the collective work of Stephen Hawking and come prepared. Come prepared to grapple with the subject. And I can just picture you now, just mind-bending, melting processes going on. We're going to get to the bottom of it. We certainly are. Next week, much to look forward to. For now, before we close our service with our last song, we're going to pray. I referred earlier to our lifeboat guys. I'm going to pray for them and for the need in our world right now. Let's bow our heads. Together, let us pray. Lord, we thank you for our church family, and that this morning we were able to welcome Scarlett into it through baptism. Bless her, we pray. And all the children and young people who make up our family. This morning, we were glad to welcome these members of our local lifeboat crew. We thank you for their willingness to serve this community, to put themselves sometimes into danger, risky situations, for the sake of others. And so a blessing upon this crew and our local boats, we pray, for safety and well-being. Lord, earlier we made notice of a meeting for those in our church who will seek to serve in our wider community, those who struggle with mental health. Again, Lord, as we have been doing in recent weeks, we pray for those in our number and in our wider community and across this nation of Scotland. Yes, we pray for those who struggle with poor mental health. Lord, where there is darkness, let there be light. Where there is despair, let there be hope. Where there is a sense of no going forward, we pray that you would open that door. Come, Almighty God, in your love, speak to us and those who struggle. And through the work that we plan, may we indeed bring hope and light to many. Lord, for our world, on this day we pray, we do so in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, stand up together. We're going to finish our service singing the last of our hymns. It's an older hymn. It's a traditional hymn. And it's called God, whose almighty word is heard. And the words will appear any moment now on our screens. I promise you, they will. See, this is what I've done, and now it's the next bit. Told you. Thank you, Karen. God, whose almighty word is heard. We sing together. There be light. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and those you love this day and forevermore. Amen. Band will continue just to play and sing gently as we begin to make our way from the church now. As I've said, if you're able, please come on down to the harbour that we might complete the sacrament of baptism this morning, remembering that there won't necessarily be lots of car parking spaces. So walk if you can, or look to park elsewhere and be down there at the harbour, and we'll join together there before too long. Now may the peace of God be with you.